then at the armed governor during former President Fidel Ramos. So we are also, during our conversations, I learned she also once worked as the chief of staff or one of the staff of the late Senate President Edgardo J. Angara. And since the late Espeja, as we call him, was also the UP president, he's our guest today, also comes from the University of the Philippines, where Angara used to be the president also. And she's the one of the resident economists during the time of Espeja. And she also took up I would like to mention about it. She was the executive member of the public administration from the London School of Economics. Anyway, without further ado, we are very proud to have today. And remember last week when we had Secretary Carlito Galvez Jr., she kept mentioning about her and giving so much gratitude for being the most supportive cabinet member on the peace process in Mindanao, because she's a Maranao and she is one of the most productive member of the cabinet of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. DBM Secretary Amena Pangandaman. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning po. Good morning to everyone.
And as ma'am. As we always do, as our guest to give the close opening statement, ma'am.
Ano ba opening statement? Well, first of all, thank you for having me, ma'am. And good morning. What I can say is just on Friday, watch out, because the president will sign our General Appropriations Act. Right now, we are working on the veto message and then consolidating all the numbers, the amendments and changes that the bicameral committee ratified last week. So we're happy that if the president signs this on the 16th, I think it's the first time na pinakamaagang napirmahan na budget. So yun po, we're happy with that.
Yeah. And tomorrow they have already the banner, the headline for tomorrow. BBM signs into law the 2023 budget.
2023 budget.
This Friday. As we have been, sabi mo nga ma'am, may veto message, and you are now preparing the veto message and everything, the president's message, can you give us a glimpse of this, kasi maraming realignments, mga amendments to the original national expenditure program that you submitted. May we have a glimpse of these things so far?
You know, ma'am, I think what's different now is maganda po yung working relationship with the executive, the House of Representatives po with Speaker Martin as our Speaker, and the Senate President, Senator Miggs Subiri. So when we turned over the NEP to them, isa lang po ang pakiusap namin that hopefully po, if you make changes or amend or introduce amendments to our NEP, hopefully it's in sync and it's anchored again with the MTFF, yung medium-term fiscal framework and the 8-point socio-economic agenda. Anyways, both houses naman po, they adopted the medium-term fiscal framework. So, from what I know po, there's amount of roughly 70 billion that they realigned. Upon our initial analysis and checking of the numbers, most of it naman went to our priority. Yes, like education, I think they put funding on SUCs, social assistance po, yung hindi po natin naabutan na nung lumabas yung batas sa ating senior citizens. And then I think they also included an amount for the EDSA carousel. Opo, so naglagay din po sila dyan, yung libreng sakay sa EDSA. And then sa health sector din po, medical assistance, they added funding. Yun po. And since maganda po yung relationship with the Congress, yung veto message po natin ngayon is very friendly. I think we only have 2 direct veto, 2 to 3 direct veto, and all the rest are just conditional and general observations.
But it goes to show na not much changes was done or were done in the original NEP.
Yes, ma'am.
And how much would be, kasi ang naging contentious dito yung mga confidential fund. Itong mga confidential funds na retained din, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. I think they, during the bicameral committee, while in the Senate, parang they removed it, pero during the ratification, it was restored. And all of those were in the NEP already.
So during the BICAM, you were there?
Ay, wala po. Bawal po tayo sa BICAM.
Kasi the BICAM is called the Third Congress, where the horse trading and all the things really, kasi closed door eh. So we don't know what happened there. But now, when it's submitted to you, you are able to vet and review all these things.
Yes, ma'am. That's why meron po tayong veto message that we release alongside with the General Appropriations Act that the President usually signs.
Being one of the economic managers of President Marcos, can we just get a glimpse of how the President's instructions to you on how to go about this, the first ever budget of the Marcos administration for the first year will be handled?
During the first, I think I was one of the first agenda items in the cabinet meeting in July, because we have a constitutional, according to the constitution, we have to submit the budget, the NEP,
1 month,
1 month
after,
yeah,
SONA.
After SONA. So the start of the administration, nagkaroon na po kami kaagad ng cabinet meeting, and then I was already part of the cabinet meeting to present yung aming NEP. So we have of course inabutan na rin po kasi natin kasi middle of the year, and we have to submit ng July. Yes. So we presented what the previous administration had prepared.
Yes.
Pero we still have time to fix it. Mm-hmm. So by the time po, we also have our cabinet members there.
Yes.
So we presented the levels and then kung ano po yung na prepare ng DBM, and then the president gave his instructions, again, consistent po dun sa SONA. So SONA po niya in our MTFF, that our budget should be anchored against that, relative to that. So, and then give all the cabinet secretaries 1 week, ma'am, to review their submission of the previous secretaries, and then you have time pa din to submit your new programs and projects. Mm. So yun po. And then after that po, I had several meetings again with the President to show kung ano na po yung result and what we're going to present to the Congress.
Since this is your first time as DBM Secretary, how did it go during your presentation of the budget, 2023 budget? How was your experience?
To the cabinet or
to the Congress?
To the Congress. Ay, nako, very, I think yun nga po, no, because I've been, I'm the secretary now, but I've been working with them for such a long time. Kasi po, with Seja po, sa Senate, I'm there for 2 times po, na 12 years po kay Senator Angara. He used to be the chairman of Committee on Finance.
Yeah.
Oh, Finance. And then I transferred po also to Senator Lauren Legarda when she was chairman of Committee on Finance. And then, so medyo familiar po ako dun sa setting nung sa legislation sa Congress.
You know,
and then
na.
Sa House din po, ganun din po, the House counterparts, I know them. So I think very comfortable. I know that nung binigay po namin yung budget, and then we gave them actually a timeline na kung pwede if they can follow the timeline. Luckily, we're advanced in the timelines that we presented to them.
Ang galing ng thinking ni BBM, no, not to top you, because you have the very wide experience in Congress. I have the best woman to do the job.
I'm grateful and honored.
Anyway, kasi ngayon ko lang nalaman, this is my first time to meet you and I got to know you better. But here comes the most challenging part, because right now there is the Maharlika funds and the economic managers, in which you are one of the key members, have supported this. From what, from your end, why are you supportive of the Maharlika Fund?
If I can give a short ano lang po, historical background. Mm. When I was, this is consistent po with what Secretary Benjoc has been telling. And actually, hopefully po, ayaw ko nga po sana magsalita about the Maharlika because it's Sec Ben who's ano sa po. But
it was supposed to take budget, di ba, from you, the national budget, because seed fund, di ba? Buti tinanggal yun.
Oo, buti tinanggal. hindi po. Nung nasa BSP po kami, because I joined Secretary yes. Benjoc no, when he was governor, during the pandemic,
yes, nga pala.
It was also the same time when the INA, yung Sovereign Wealth Fund po ng Indonesia, was established. It was all over the news during the time.
Okay.
And then Secretary Benjoc, no, governor then, asked us to review and then to check if the BSP can establish its own Sovereign Wealth Fund.
Okay.
Because during that time, of course, we respect po that pagkaibang governor, magkaiba po ang policy decisions,
yes.
di ba? And directives. During that time, we really have a surplus in our reserves.
Okay.
The IMF po says that we should only have at least 3 months of our reserves.
Yes.
But during Governor Jocno's time, it was 10 months.
Wow.
Alam ni Mau yan. Oo, oh. Sila yung mga nagko-cover po sa governor.
It was more,
yes po. So, sobra-sobra po. So, he said, pag-aralan nyo nga how we can go about this. So, we did our research, TWG po. We even met with, I think he mentioned this, we even met with the ADB,
yes.
with the IMF, uh-huh. kung okay.
Uh-huh.
Both development partners said it's okay, pero hindi po sa central bank. Kasi wala po sa mandate ng central bank.
Okay.
Yung ano.
Okay.
Pwede, pero you need to revise the mandate and the charter of the Banko Sentral ng Pilipinas.
Okay.
So, when we had a meeting, so siguro pa the cabinet, it was also mentioned that why not create one. So, during the TWGs po, 30 time pa po yan. So, during the TWGs po, lumabas yung INA, yung sa Indonesia po. From my end po, any measure, program, law that will help our budget po, given our limited space right now, it's a welcome news po for me, and at least for the end of the DBM po. So, yun po. Kaya we will support po the Maharlika Wealth Fund, the creation of the Wealth Fund.
So, from what's coming out from the House right now, ang sources of funds nasa Land Bank, DBP, and may pagkor pa yata ang
ESP, may pagkor, uh-huh. there are privatization proceeds.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Is that okay with you?
Yes, ma'am. Of course, ma'am.
Okay.
Opo.
So, but as you said, in the past, when it was first studied, there was a 10 month surplus on the GIR, but right now we are only 3.
It's 8 months na lang po yata, 8 to 9 months, because they had to, because of the pandemic po, and then the depreciation of our
Tapos yung mga interest rates medyo na federal interest rates.
Mm.
So as far as you see it, the economic team sees it, it's still, well, it augurs well to start it now.
Yes, ma'am. I'm not sure if I'm sobrang advanced to, but just this morning, part of our TWG was a meeting with the Milken Institute of Singapore. They will release soon a report. And then I think the report will say that the time is now. We don't have to wait for it to start and create our own sovereign wealth fund. It's not yet for public consumption, but I think it will be released soon.
But that is the Singapore what, ma'am?
Milken Institute from Singapore.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We also tapped them to help us. When we were working on the TWG.
Mm-hmm.
Kung anong klase. Kasi marami pong klase yung sovereign wealth fund. Yung iba po, they're using it for their pension system. Yung iba po, for their natural resources.
Oh.
Ako, I think, yung atin po, it's for our development. Diba? To develop and to fund our at least infrastructure projects and programs.
Parang PPP.
Parang ganyan po, opo. Iba-iba pong klase yung mga models na meron.
CPLC, JPE, Chief Presidential Legal Counsel Juan Ponce Enrile has publicly advised the President not to be not to align or identify himself with the Maharlika, because the ultimate obligation or ultimate responsibility will be thrown at him. What's your take on that, ma'am? That's the legal point, huh? From the economic point of view.
I think po, it's a legislation, it's a proposed bill, and there's a process that they are undergoing now. I'm happy po that with the first version, ngayon po, we have already incorporated yung mga comments po ng public. And then, at least in the Congress, I know that they have more than almost 200 supporters now.
Yes.
Dahil nakinig po sila sa gusto ng taong bayan. So, I think the version that we have now, that they're going to pass, is a result of a consultation from the public. Siguro, let's just maybe follow the process. Galing po kasi ako sa Senado.
Yes.
So, alam ko po yung legislature, no? So, after sa House, pupunta pa po yan sa Senado, and then there will be committee hearings, public consultations, marami pa pong mangyayari. So, let's just respect the process of legislation. And then, may bicameral committee pa po yan. So, when the right time comes po, and eventually, if the version that they pass during the bicam is really kung ano po yung
final version.
Yes, the final version is, kasi po sinasabi nga natin, even the ano, it's high time to have one. So for me po, let's just follow the process, whatever po may result, kung ipasa po ng Kongreso, mapirmahan, we'll just implement it properly.
Pardon me for taking the devil's advocate. Kasi ang nangyari sa House, naging baliktad ang process eh. Yung consultation took place after there were some adverse reactions. Eh ngayon sa Senate, wala namang version. But this morning I heard Speaker Romualdez is asking Senator Mark Villar, having a family engaging investments, to author it at the Senate, kasi wala pa ngayon.
Again, ma'am, galing ako sa Senado.
Yes.
Pag gumagawa kami ng bill, wala pa kaming consultation really.
Okay.
Unless may nag-request sa amin na group.
Yes,
si Speaker. Kunyari may nag-request sa amin na group, kunyari health workers, pupunta sa amin, ma'am, baka pwede niyo po kami tulungan.
Okay.
We will propose a bill, pakiayos po. But there are also other bills na dahil, kunyari po, si Senator Angara, this is what I heard before, yung senior citizens,
yes.
He was the main author of senior citizens. Galing lang po siya sa Amerika. Pagbalik, wala pa po ako sa kanya noon, bata pa po ako noon, nag-aaral pa ako. But kwento lang niya sa akin to. So pagbalik niya, sinabihin niya yung legis group niya, i-file niya tong bill na to. So, i-file niyo tong bill na to. Prepare the bill. So, once they prepare, nung pagka-prepare po nila ng bill, pinirmahan, final. Pagka-file po sa Senate, may first reading. Diyan po nagsisimula ang mga consultations at saka public hearings. So, tama po yung proseso na ginawa ng ating HOR. And I know that, since nga po, I gave the historical background, may mga TWGs, may mga report na po tayo, and there's a lot of literatures all over about the establishment of sovereign wealth fund. Hindi po siya rocket science, I think.
Yes, ako. Hindi nga rocket science. Pero it came to public knowledge. I'll give you the timeline. Monday, it was approved at the House panel. Kasi may first reading na, House panel. Approved agad. Dapat di ba pa-public hearing ka muna? Walang ganun. So it came out the next day, Tuesday. And on Wednesday, guest ko si Secretary Benjocno, and he traced us the origins of that. Yung nga sabi, ako author niyan. Sa BSP. Oh, yes. Tapos 2 weeks after ito, here comes the President saying, parang inako na niya, parang, kasi si Speaker Romualdez was saying, it's the President's wish that we have the Maharlika Fund. Kaya, hindi namin malaman, ano which version ba papaniwalaan namin?
It's a consolidated effort po of the executive department and the legislative department po.
Kasi na ultimate ano that
but ma'am, di ba nakikita naman natin democracy at work, di ba?
Yes.
O di ba? Pagka the first version yung mayroon pang GSIS and
yes.
SSS, nakinig naman po yung ating mga legislators,
yes,
di ba?
Yeah.
And then they removed it. And now they're fine tuning the the bill po. And then we're looking that ano po, at least marami na rin po yung nakukuha nating positive response with the creation of the fund.
And I'm getting assured that you at as the DBM and coming from the Senate, you know, alam mo ang kanilang, you know where to find yung mga flaws in the laws that must be corrected right now before it can become a law. Otherwise, mag-veto yun.
Yes, ma'am. I'm sure, especially when it gets to the Senate, the economic team will be called, and then there will, I'm sure din po that the committee will be converted into a technical working group. Medyo matagal na proseso din po yan. Pagkatapos ng technical working group, you will present it again to the committee. Pagkatapos ng committee, ma'am, magkakaroon ka po ng committee report and then plenary. Mahabang proseso po po to. Lahat ng gustong magbigay ng kanilang amendments and recommendation, dissenting opinion, positive opinion, lahat po papasok pa during the Senate deliberations. Mahaba.
Last question naman, Maharlika. How were you able to convince BSP Governor Medalla? Kasi siya yung unang pumiyok doon, kaya nagkagulo ng gusto doon sa ano, Maharlika funds.
I think generally, he's okay with the creation of the Sovereign Wealth Fund. Ang alam ko po, ang hindi lang okay sa kanya, is the yung use po ng reserves. Again, dalawang governor po, magkaiba yung policy decision always and direction. When during the time of Governor Jokno, he was okay, but there's a new governor, he was not. So sabi niya, oh, we can. Ayaw niya gamitin because of course he has a mandate to consider for monetary policy decisions and all. So sabi niya, they can, but they can provide yung dividends ng BSP.
Okay. Let's shift to the more technocratic. Because I know the DBM, yan ang ano, ang kailangan dyan, di ba? Corruption free. And the buzzword is digitalization is the answer to at least reduce, if not totally remove corruption. How will the DBM play out this digitalization? Because DBM is so aggressive in pushing for digitalization, all the government activities.
During the, let's go back again po, since it is a priority of our president, Bongbong Marcos, when we presented the budget, yung first budget po, the draft that we presented, yung naabutan po namin, during that time, wala pa po, hindi pa po dyan nakapasok yung digitalization efforts ng gobyerno. Because I think, of course, last term na rin po ng Duterte administration. So nung cabinet meeting po, sinabi po ni Presidente that he's also pro-digitalization for para po to ma-reduce yung cost of doing business, transparency, and accountability. So, nung binalik po sa amin to review, he asked us to incorporate and he asked all the cabinet members also to check their programs and introduce programs para po ma-incorporate yung digitalization efforts sila. So, nung lumabas po yung second version, most of the agencies po, we adopted yung kanilang mga digitalization programs. From the DB, so, pumasok po yun sa budget natin. So, we have more than 300 billion. We have provided more than 300 billion for the digitalization program of the different national government agencies. NGA po, kasama din po dyan yung sa the Bureau of Customs and BIR, it's about 3 billion. So, 3 billion po in total, sa kanila pong dalawa yun. So, yun, so, there's 300 billion worth of projects in the national government, which is in the NEP. I think it's still there sa ating GAA. And then from the DBM's end po, last week, we just signed a memorandum of agreement with the three banks, depository banks po ng national government, DBP, Land Bank, and Veterans Bank. Yung pag nagre-release po kasi kami ng pondo, tapos may cash po, usually po, we have the SARO and NCA. Lahat po yan dumadaan sa bureau, sa director, sa assistant governor, and lahat po yan hard copy. And when we release it, hard copy. So, and then the agencies will go to us, di ba, kukuha sila ng hard copy, mamamasahe pa sila, tapos nakapila sila doon, di ba? Ngayon po, digital na yan, ini-email na lang po sa kanila yan. So, wala na po tayong hard copy ng ating mga release documents.
It's starting January 1st.
Yes, ma'am. Yung SARO po, nag-start na last year. Yung NCA po will start January. And then, to follow po yung mga our yung NOSCA when we create positions. Ano nga yung NOSCA? Notice of when we create ano nga yung NOSCA? Pag nag-create po kami ng positions, nagre-release kami ng NOSCA. Yan din po, hard copy din po yan. Na makapal na dokumento, nandoon yung kung ilang position, magkano yung salary niya.
Para maiwasan mga ghost employees.
Opo, makapal yan. So yan, ano na rin po yan, magiging digital means na rin yan. So, dun sa NCA pa lang, if we start next year, we will save at least 33 million pesos.
On what?
On the printing and the cost of paper. Kasi special paper. Special paper po yan eh, para pag napunta po sa masamang tao, hindi po niya magamit. May mga security features, yes, parang pera po. So, we don't have to print that. So, 33 million yan. So, hopefully po, until first SEM of next year, lahat po ng releases ng DBM, wala na pong hard copy. It will all be digital.
Yes. Kasi alam mo, having covered the government for so many years, including the DBM, NCA and SARO, source of corruption niya, na pepeki pa yan, di ba? Ang daming kaso niya sa ombudsman na dahil sa SARO and NCA. So, that is one evil away. O, two
yes,
evils
ma'am.
Away.
Opo, kasi diretso siya dun sa tao ng agency. So, pag may lumabas dyan, ikaw lang yan. Ikaw ang ikaw naglabas niyan, di ba?
How do you deal with hackers? Mamaya naman, hackers sa mga kalaban niyo.
Ay, ma'am, if there's digitalization effort, malaki din po ang investment mo on cybersecurity. So, it's medyo malaki po ang investment, funding na kailangan natin. But I think at the end of the day po, yung savings that we will incur from all the digitalization effort will, mas advantageous for the national government.
I'm assuming that implement na January 1st, so there is already the cybersecurity.
Yes, ma'am. Opo. It's parallel po. When you invest on something, software or any application, I just know it, hindi ko alam yung mga terms. I'm lucky enough to hire an undersecretary who's into digital infrastructure and AI. So siya po yung tumutulong sa akin. So when you fund for your digital systems and software and hardware, you also fund the cybersecurity part of that system. Parang ganyan po.
So, wala na yung mga impounding ng budget niyan?
Wala po. At saka wala rin po ang mga for later release na ganyan.
Oo. Pumipila sa Malacanang.
Wala na
mga
po.
EDUs.
No? wala po.
No need for the lobbying to the president ba yan?
Wala na po. Wala na. Everything is in the General Appropriations Act.
Oh, anyway, and as I mentioned earlier, you were the most praised official, cabinet official of the OPAP project.
Ito po ang NOSCA. Ayan. Notice of Organization, Staffing, and Compensation Action. Napakahaba din naman ng dapat notice of compensation, staffing and compensation.
Oh, notice.
Ayan.
Anyway, yan ang mawawalang mga copy, ng mga hard copy.
Wala na po, wala na. So, makakatipid tayo sa gasolina, especially now, na mahal ang fuel, pupunta pa yung mga tao.
Mag-absent pa yung LGU.
Yes, ma'am.
Anyways, ma'am, as was say a while ago, it's a barn. Because you are identified with the most peaceful tribe in Mindanao, the Maranao, and the favorite tribe of President Duterte, who identifies himself as a Maranao. I would like to take from, so to speak, horse's mouth, why are you so endeared to the OPAP project?
Like you mentioned po, first of all, I'm from Lanao del Sur po. The Pangandamans po came from, it's a little town in Lanao del Sur, it's called Masyo. But yung mother side naman po ng father ko is Diron, sila po yung tiga Marawi. So why is it close to my heart? While I am born and raised in your Metro Manila, wala po kasi akong kapatid. So nag-iisa ako. So lahat
Only
po
daughter.
Ng most of my cousins are in Marawi. So every summer po, dinadala po ako ng magulang ko doon. I spend time with my cousins and my relatives in Marawi. Buong summer po nandoon ako. So I get to see the difference kung ano yung merong improvements in NCR and in Mindanao. So siguro yun po na ano sa mind ko na siguro while I'm here in Metro Manila, most of the roads are paved, pag-uwi ko sa probinsya, hindi. Opo. And then most of the peace and order situation and issues nandoon sa Mindanao.
Gidas kayo, gidas. Opo, opo. Geographically isolated so, as advantages.
Yes, ma'am. Tama po yan. Opo. So, yun. So, and then, I'm lucky also that the president appointed me, designated me as the co-chair for the IGRB.
Okay.
Yung IGRB po, this is one of the mechanisms under the Bangsamoro Organic Law that will process and resolve issues from then arm to barn.
Yes.
And then help them with the process of their transition, because we know that by 2025, kasi elections. Ngayon po they're all appointed, di ba?
Yes.
By 2025, there will be elections.
Yes.
Opo.
Kaya nga ma, may black grant pa sila nang sabi ni Secretary, ma 80 billion na ngayon, dati 70 billion dahil may extra grants.
60 billion po, opo. 60 billion and then we have special fund, special development that we also give them. So, under the IGRB, there are 7 mechanisms po. Out of 7, yung 5 mechanisms na organize na po namin and then na-convene na po, there are other 2 mechanisms that have yet to be convened. This is the Council of Leaders and the Bangsamoro Sustainable Development Board.
Mama, sustainable
opo. So I'm happy to note po that even if in such a short time, two months pa lang, no, when we were designated as the co-chair of the IGRB, nag-organizational meeting na po yung national government and last October, we already had our first IGRB meeting with the Bangsamoro panel 2 weeks ago sa Davao po yung ginawa.
Yes.
Tapos nag-meeting na rin po yung tinatawag nating Philippine Congress Bangsamoro Parliament Forum. And we already have the composition from House of Representatives and from the Senate of the Philippines. And at the same time, nag-convene na rin po yung Intergovernmental Fiscal Policy Board. Ito po yung nag-aaral ng mga revenue measures po ng bagong Bangsamoro.
May revenue code na ang gagawin niya sila.
Yes po. In fact, during the Davao trip po, they approved 3 revenue measures. This is the documentary stamp tax, real estate tax. I'm not sure po. Pero may 3 po silang pinasa na tax nila.
Clarify ko lang, ma'am. Pag may black grant na, di ba annual na to black grant sa farm, they are no longer entitled to RIA, Internal Revenue Allotments.
Yes, ma'am.
Hindi na.
Opo. Opo.
The rest will go to the LGUs.
Yes, ma'am.
Speaking of IRA, how will the PDBM implement that Mandanas ruling?
Ah, okay po. Of course, we know that the IRA for this for next year will be much lower.
Much lower.
Much lower po siya kasi po ng by 138 billion. Because of 138 billion po.
Because of the pandemic.
Because of the pandemic. Kasi yun po yung nakalagay sa batas eh. Kung ano po yung revenues ng national government from the past 2 years. And then okay. Kukumpute mo yun, yun. So mas mababa po siya. So,
138 billion lower.
138 billion lower.
Dati ba, saan ko ima-minus ng
800 billion this year, I think. Oh, this year. So, less. So less siya ngayon. So
how many
mas mababa po.
How
lahat
many,
po. Lahat po ng LGUs natin. So nagkaroon po I think our LGUs po dumulog po sila kay SILG. Kay SILG natin at saka sa presidente po on how we can go about it. Kasi meron po tayong Executive Order 138. Ito po yung for the implementation of the Mandanas Law.
Yes.
I think during our meeting po, our common recommendation po is to extend the support of the national government. Yung EO 138 po, I think yung support natin para po sa full transition ng ating Mandanas-Garcia Law hanggang 2024? Hanggang 2024 lang po.
Uh-huh.
But then, with the proposal po to extend, it will be until 2027 po. Ang ibig sabihin po niyan, the national government can still support our LGUs po.
Pero
we can still provide funding for them.
Can still support LGUs up to 2027.
Yes, ma'am. By that time, siguro, hindi lang po to, kasi Supreme Court decision po to, hindi lang po to in terms of monetary support.
Yes.
Pati po capacity building and technical support po sa kanila. Kasi we know that there are big ticket items like yung paggawa po siguro ng mga bridges,
yes.
Narinig ko din po yung mga right-of-way, yeah, right-of-way mechanisms, oh, and kung paano makipag... yung mga legal, ganyan. Parang hindi pa po kaya ng LGUs natin yan. So with the EO-138 and the extension, tuloy-tuloy po yung mga capacity building and seminar and workshops natin with LGUs. Magkakaroon po tayo ng roadshow dyan starting next year with the help of...
roadshow all over the Philippines?
All over the Philippines po, para matulungan po natin sila. Kasama po natin dyan ang DOF at saka ang DILG and DBM po for public financial management on how to budget, on how to do procurement, kung paano po mag implement ng project, and then and DAP po. I think we will DAP, Development Academy of the Philippines, to help us.
Yung extension to 2027, is that an EO or just
it's a... It's an EO, ma'am. Because 138 po. Because there's an existing EO during the time of President Duterte. So the proposal is to extend it.
Okay.
So lalabas po yan.
Okay. And on the lighter side of things, how is the DBM? On track ba kayo sa pagbibigay ng Christmas bonus to government employees?
Yes, we have narilista po namin yung maaga po magbigay ng Christmas bonus ang national government. Yung 13-month pay, baka nagastos na nga yata eh. December, no? November pa yata, narilis na po namin. And then may mga several mga maliliit na bonuses dyan na lalabas siguro sa susunod na mga araw.
Mga happy news to the government.
May mga good news po. Opo. Oh. Hopefully.
Mapaka-explain mo kanina, I was asking Maureen kanina, his story about bakit tumaas ang budget ng 2022 than the Congress approved project.
Hindi po siya tumaas. Budget. The level po ng budget natin is the same, yung 2022. But if you look at our budget po kasi, there's unprogram appropriations.
Unprogram.
Yan po yung mga programs na hindi po natin alam. It's a fund.
Parang
na naka-standby, hindi po saving. Standby po siya na funds na
funds.
If ever kailanganin, we can tap. Pero the only way you can trigger the release of that is kung may excess revenues tayo. So, just because I think we open up our economy, makikita niyo naman po, traffic na ngayon. And, di ba? Tapos, malakas yung trade, yung lahat po, economic activity, lahat po. So, ibig sabihin po niya, mas marami kang revenues. So, maraming gastos na dumadating po, like yung mga, ano ba yung mga pinondohan natin? Support to our agriculture sector because nagmahal yung mga produkto natin. Tapos kailangan po natin pondohan yung EDSA carousel kasi I think hanggang last year lang yun. This year, hanggang June lang yun. So pinondohan natin hanggang end of the year. And then pinondohan din po natin yung mga health workers natin. Wala po kasi siyang item sa loob ng
so
nandoon siya sa program. So pag nagkaroon po tayo excess revenues, yun po yung mga pinondohan natin during that time. Alam niyo ba yun, yung mga nirelease.
Paid for na yung mahinihiling ng mga healthcare workers.
Hindi pa po kompleto, pero medyo malaki na po yung nailabas natin. But we're in touch with DOH po para po kung may kulang pa po. I think sa 2023, meron pa po yung tong pondo na nakalaan for them.
Last question before I open it to the floor, since na-mention mo na, ma'am. Yung procurement of bivalent vaccine against COVID, does the DBM have funds for that?
Ah, yes po, meron po.
So,
may funds po sa 2020, may naiwan pa po sila for 2022, and then meron pa rin pong sa 2023.
So how soon mabibili yung bivalent?
I heard po that, I think this, if not this December, nakita ko po sa press release yata ng DOH, if not this December, January.
Okay, so yung make sure lang na hindi mawa-waste na, sayang, no?
Yes po.
Pero sabi ng COVAX, papalitan nila yun.
Sabi po ni Secretary Galvez, when I also asked him, kasi marami po yata yung mag-expire, sabi niya, part of the agreement is that they will replace yung mga mag-expire.
Tsaka maganda explanation ni Secretary Galvez, the cost of saving lives has no monetary value.
Correct, ma'am.
Okay. On that note, I would like to open the floor for questions. Okay. Please introduce yourself first.
Good Good morning, Secretary. Good morning. President Katarong from SMNI News. Regarding po sa Maharlika Investment Fund, pagdating po sa safeguards nitong panukalaga, ano po ito kalakas po para mapangalagaan po yung
pera? I think the Secretary Ben already enumerated yung 8 safeguards that is present in the current bill. Hindi ko lang memorize, but I know that first, may COA po yan. Hindi po siya exempted from COA. And then second, there will be a external, apart from COA, may external audit ka pa. Tapos meron pa silang internal audit nila outside COA. And then they have, ano pa ba? Of course, yung Santiago principles. Kailangan, mas mahaba po yung Santiago principles. Opo, yung 8 po, yun yung present dun sa bill natin. According to the Santiago principles. Opo. So, ano pa ba? Yung board, di ba? Yung board po, it will be composed of people from the private sector, from the national government. May advisory ka pa, di ba? Yung advisory mo, yung economic managers nyo and Bureau of Treasury. And may oversight ka pa ng Congress. Oh, so, parang nakakulong na nga masyado yung ako. When I saw it, sabi ko, kulong na kulong naman tong pondo na to. Baka hindi na to magamit, di ba? So, but I think it's present. Alam niyo po, we don't have to be parang so scared because while I'm reading some of the literatures, I know that may mga pangamba po ang mga tao, but when I'm reading the literatures, parang more than 200 years ago na po yung creation ng Sovereign Wealth Fund. And then, more than 100 MAM countries have their own Sovereign Wealth Funds. And then, may Santiago principles ka pa. Tapos, they have this institute, Sovereign Wealth Fund Institute, na nag-aaral ng lahat ng mga Sovereign Wealth Funds natin na nag-create. And then, meron pa silang tinatawag na transparency rating from an international company which also looks at the operations of our Sovereign Wealth Funds. So, parang, I think that's more than enough, no, to at least make sure that yung pondo po na ilalagay natin doon will be put in good use.
Secretary, na-mention niyo po kanina na maliban po doon sa na-mention niyo po na infrastructure projects, ano po sa tingin niyo ang magandang paglagakan pa ng Maharlika Fund kung sakaling maipasa o may patupad ito?
For me, talaga siguro malaking part po kasi talaga ng budget is yung infrastructure, our mobility, and ano, so more than that siguro, kasama na rin to sa infrastructure, power and energy, and yung ICT po, yung telecom. Yan.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Hi, good morning po, Secretary. Mads Villar po from Net25. Ma'am, you mentioned po kanina na now is the time to create the Sovereign Fund for the Philippines. Pwede pong paki-elaborate lang din yung ano pong ibig niyong sabihin na now is the time given na ang laki po lalo ng utang ng Pilipinas and unti-unti pa lang po tayong bumabangon because of the COVID-19 pandemic. Thank you po.
Nung ginawa po, kasi siguro ang training po natin kailangan, we read and then we study. Nung when we were having our own TWG meetings in the creation of the Sovereign Wealth Fund, ang naging best example ko po nung sa Sovereign Wealth Fund is yung sa Indonesia. Yun sa Indonesia Investment Authority. We call it INA. When they created that fund, it was in the middle of pandemic. 2020. Nasa gitna po ng pandemic. They thought during that time na kailangan mag-separate sila ng fund to fund their developmental projects. Kalagitnaan po yun ng pandemic when everyone was trying to find money and revenue for their own people. They started with only $5 billion. Now, after 2 years, it's $22.5 billion. So, siguro, I think, yun nga sinasabi po natin, no, there are best practices na pwede natin gamitin at incorporate doon sa ginagawa nating Sovereign Wealth Fund.
Ma'am, yung sinasabi po kasi nung iba, yung like for example sa Indonesia po and other countries, yung ginagamit nila for the fund is yung sobrang-sobrang pera. Unlike us, na parang kukunin siya sa mga reserve na pondo na alam naman daw na kailangan din talaga natin na meron tayong reserve.
Iba-iba po ang formula ng paggawa ng fund. Yung sa Indonesia po, wala po silang surplus. Oo. Parang tayo din yan. May oil po sila. Opo. So, with the different formula po in the creating of wealth, wala po kasi tayong oil, di ba? So, at least dun sa bill natin, we have provided several options kung saan tayo pwede makakuha ng fund. We should start from something.
Ma'am, last na lang po on my end. Sabi po ng DOH, sumulat na raw po sila sa DBM para ma-request yung mga pondo para sa COVID allowance ng health workers until, may bigay nila until December daw na allowance. Sumagot na po ba yung DBM dito?
I'll have to check po kung mayroon pong nabigay sila sa amin na request. I'll have to check on that.
Thank you, ma'am. Apo.
Yun, hindi email yun, ma'am. Yung mga request, hindi email.
Email.
Email, pwede. Diretso sa ano. dbn.gov.ph.
Yes, ma'am. Pwede, yung mga national government agencies po natin, may direct email yan ng mga bureaus natin eh. Kung saan po sila assign na bureau.
And you entertain those requests.
Of course. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, ma'am. Maureen from Philippine Star. Ma'am, just want to ask on further elaboration on the Milken Institute study that you mentioned a while ago. Ha? Yeah. Is this new, ma'am, or nag-start lang yung pag-tap nyo dun sa Milken with the proposal of this admin, or may prior na during the when BSP Governor Jokno was still in possession?
During that time, it was only ADB and IMF, but yung Milken Institute, it was July.
So when
July
the,
or August
when the economic team was crafting
already
the,
formed, yeah.
And ma'am, based on the initial result of the study, you said that it is the Milken Institute said that it is time to do this now.
Yeah, they're recommending the creation of the SWF.
May iba pa, ma'am, na tinap yung government to do further studies to at least have many.
I think Secretary Ben Jokno is talking to World Bank. And we will also start engaging again with ADB and IMF. Kasi during that time, parang naputol po kasi they don't like BSP to be the to be the one to handle the sovereign wealth fund kasi hindi daw po pwede. So now that we have a new law, I think SecBen, I know that nagsimula yung World Bank, I think they met last week
to discuss, ma'am, on the probability of the wealth fund.
Yes, yes.
Ma'am, just another question. The DBCC revised the targets for next year. The DBCC lowered the growth to around 6-7%. Even with the revision, ma'am, other banks and multilaterals and think tanks are saying that the government may still not be able to reach the 6-7% given the global headwinds. Do you have other measures to be implemented next year to at least reach the target? Kasi according to them, it would still be difficult to even hit the 6-7%.
I think that the policy to continually open up the economy, that's first. I think that will be of help. Second, from our end, wala na po kaming for later release. So starting January, we will release all the fund, all the kung ano po yung nasagaan natin. So lahat po ng mga programa natin, social program, infrastructure, so we expect everything will be implemented and operating by next year. So I guess all of this, and then plus yung of course our other cabinet secretaries are doing their very best and working hard triple time to get investors like DTI po, para po, and then they're promoting MSMEs, lahat po ng assistance na kailangan natin. And at the same time, yung PPP po, which we are actively promoting. So I guess all of this, no, iba-ibang inputs from the national government, I think it will help us, diba, to at least achieve our 6-7% growth for next year.
Ma'am, just last question. Yung infra spending natin as of end September is below the government program. How do we intend to ramp this up towards the end of the year and moving forward next year with the first budget of the admin?
Marami po kasi natigil nung first semester because of the election ban. So after that, nung naupo na po tayo, we were able to release a lot of funding. Kasi, and then there's a new government, there's new cabinet secretary, there's new senior officers. So ngayon po, itong December, September, October, November, marami na pong request for NCA, and SARO, nung all of the other projects. So lahat po yan, pinapaspasa natin para makapagsimula po sila lahat.
Mimit naman, ma'am, yung government program for the...
Yes, yes. Kasi at least for the DOTR and DPWH, medyo malaki na rin po yung nare-release so far.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, yung sinabi mong Indonesian sovereign fund, how much did they start again?
$2 billion, ma'am.
Oo. Pero ngayon, ang favorite example ng mga critics ng mga Harlega, most of them, aside from the Malaysia na nasa corruption na punta, yung sa Norway na much rooted about, has lost in August, and many of them are also losing, so it's not the right time.
Sabi ko nga po, merong best practices, merong hindi. So, ngayong ginagawa natin yung bill natin, siguro pag-aralan natin yung lahat ng best practices and then yung mga masasamang nangyari, we make sure na hindi present yung ginagawa nila, wala po sa bill natin para we learn from their mistakes.
Hmm. Yung two previous bills sa Senate, ni filed before, ni Bam Aquino and JB, have you read the literatures of that?
Yes, yes, when I was in BSP.
So, what do you think of those bills?
The concept itself is the same, pero magkaiba lang yata yung the governance, magkaiba po, kung saan manggagaling yung funds. So, we also looked at it when we were drafting when we were working on the study for the BSP during that time.
Questions from the floor? Okay, please introduce yourself. Medyo mag-dark doon eh.
Ma'am,
tanong ko lang, ma'am.
Nakukod nyo na naman.
Pat Santos of Trivion.
Ma'am, madilim ko siya rito eh.
Nakukod nyo na naman ako.
Para wala na yung araw.
Hey, ma'am, tanong ko lang, ma'am. Yung past experience ng yung allocation ng budget, meron bang pork barrel, ma'am, sa na nakatago sa ibang terminology, pork barrel, yung pork barrel naging controversial no
sa budget po natin. Wala na pong ganyan ngayon kasi may Supreme Court decision na po diyan eh,
ibang name.
Let's be honest.
Wala na po. Lahat po naka-identify na sa kaya nga po ang kapal-kapal nung nagsisimula po ako dati sa Senate. Nung kami po ni Senator Anggara, ang budget po, parang dalawang ganyan lang kakapal. Opo, ngayon apat na. Diba, we try to list down line by line lahat ng proyekto. Opo, yun po requirement.
So kung wala, ma'am,
bigat
magkano ang allocation per congressman?
Ay, hindi ko po alam. May allocation po ba sila?
Ewan ko po, kaya nga po...
Wala po.
Bawal
na po yung may Supreme Court decision na yan.
Pero it gives open.
Kasi po nung ako, I'll be honest, so nasa Senate po, kay Senator Anggara, meron pong countrywide development fund na naka-lump sum doon. Yun. Ngayon, PDAF. Yun ba yung countrywide?
Hindi, countrywide muna, tapos naging PDAF.
Tapos may PDAF. Yun. Talaga nandoon yung lump sum yun, walang lista yun. Ngayon, wala nang ganun doon. Lahat nakalista.
Ngayon,
lahat may definition, lahat may guidelines, lahat may circular.
Kaya lahat ngayon nakapila sa Malacanang.
Wala na po nakapila kasi nasa gaan na eh. Oh. So, re-release na yon kagad.
Ang pinipilaan yung pagpapa-release.
Kasi wala na po akong for later release. Kaya sila pumipila dati kasi meron pong for later release last year. In fact, hanggang ngayon,
FLT nga pala.
Nag-FLR po.
FLR, oo.
Hanggang ngayon, may mga for later release pa ako na binabato po sa Malacanang. Napakadami.
Oo.
Napakadami.
So how do you...
Sayang ang papel.
How did you solve the FLR?
No, ma'am, kasi po during... When I was with Secretary Ben Jokno, and then I asked the senior officers din po of DBM, wala naman pong for later release previously.
Oo.
So sabi ko, parang... I think one of the reasons din kaya bumagal yung mga releases natin eh. Kasi nga may for later release. Imagine, when they submit to us tanong yung staff namin, yung dokumento ng for later release, ganyan.
Bakit?
So, pag nag-submit sila ng request, ito po yung mga amendments kasi sa sa budget. Dadating sa amin, pag-aaralan ng bureau namin, akit sa akin, Tapos, i-endorse ko sa Office of the President, pag-aaralan ng Office of the President on top of what they're already doing. And then, approve nila. Pagdating po sa amin, may approval. Tapos, babalik kami dun sa ahensya. May hahingin kami additional document. Tapos, i-release namin yung SARO. Tapos, pag... medyo mahaba po yung
process. So, paano ginawa mo? Ano pa? How did you solve that?
Wala na pong fair later release. So, yung sa starting January, alam ni Mau yan. Ano po, yung GAA po, memorize niyan budget ano eh, yung budget beat natin, economic beat natin. Release document na po yung GAA, comprehensive release na po.
Yan ang maganda.
Kaya ako lang natanong yan ma'am, kasi yung pondo nung 6 months ni BPM, galing pa sa unang ano eh.
Previous.
So itong unang taon na full budget kay
Marcos.
Disposal ni Marcos. Kaya baka ako may mga nakatago.
Wala po. Pag ano po, pwede niyo po makita. Siguro on the 16 was a sign. Monday, nasa website na namin. Oh, yung detalye ng budget.
Yeah.
Ayan, nakikita ko na kayo, sir.
Pati ba naman kayo, ma?
Brother, nakikita ka. Brother, nakikita ka.
Ako kasi sa post, eh.
Against the line ka kasi.
Ewan ko sa'yo, may joke.
Pakita natin sa camera si sir.
Regular copy okay. Na namin.
Opo, thank you po.
Akala ko sa'yo, Eric Balcos, Pagkor. May tanong ka ba? Pero ang kalaban ng Pagkor, DOF, they want to privatize Pagkor daw eh. How much ang contribution? Yes, ma'am. Vice President for Community Affairs. Oh! Eric Balcos.
Hi. Hello po. Hello po kay Chairman.
Hi, Eric.
Hello po kay Chairman Altenco. Kanina pa ako.
Yung Pagkor daw, yung Pagkor.
I think, ano po, nandun, one of the sources, possible sources. Kasi mayroon naman privatization, ano dun eh, may provision dun that any proceeds from the privatization can also be tapped for the sovereign
fund. Naku, pa-privatize na daw Pagkor.
I think they're okay with the privatization.
Ayaw daw nila eh.
Hindi! Ayaw mo?
No comments yan. You mean to say yung casino operation, yung regulatory functions, i-give up ng...
Parang ano po eh, di ba? Parang BSP.
Oh.
Yung BSP walang banko. They just regulate the banks.
Yes.
So parang ganun yung concept.
Regulatory na. Hindi na sila go-operate. Wala nang pag-operated. Tama nga naman yung Eric. Umayag na kayo. Teka ma'am, ang budget natin, how much ang budget is supported by POGOS casinos? Aside pa, naman ng tax revenues, how much of the total budget?
Hindi ko po memorize. DOF. Wala pa akong BESF eh. Baka...
Wala kang rough estimate kasi, diba sabi mo, yung pandemic.
Ayun sa POGO. I know that the POGO contributes mga 7 billion, no? Sabi nila.
But,
maliit, pero there are ancillary revenues pa dyan, di ba? Yes. Yung sa real estate.
So
hindi pa yun consolidated doon.
Multiplier.
Yung kumakain sila dito.
Yes,
they go, yung multiplier, opo. May value added pa.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Okay. Wala na kayong tanong kay Secretary Amina?
Yes, ma'am.
Gina Mape.
Good morning, Secretary. Gina Mape
po. Secretary, sinasabi, best practice ang Indonesian model. Kasi nga, mga Indonesian ay matatapat sa kanilang mga tungkulin. Ngayon po, ito po bang ating Maharlika Wealth Fund? Ano po yung mga measure para mapanatili po yung transparency ng pag-Google o investment ng ating pamahalaan? Kung ano man po yung mga...
Nasabi niya na iba, pero if you want to clarify, how do you find po transparency?
Yung 8 measures po na mention. Siguro I can provide letter. Later the details of the 8 measures. Meron, si Yusek Margo meron. Opo. Yun po yung mag-provide sa atin. Opo. And then I mentioned also yung Sovereign Wealth Institute. Pag nagkaroon po tayo ng Sovereign Wealth Fund, magiging part po tayo niyan. And then meron po, may organization po siya. So they release a quarterly publication on that.
Uh-oh.
Kung saan napupunta. And then meron din pong index, transparency index from an international, it's here. Wait lang po.
Uh-oh. magiging member tayo noon, institute.
Ano nababasa natin?
Mm. Sabi mo nga, maraming literature.
Lena Bird Model Transparency Index.
Magiging member
din
tayo
niya. It's an index developed for Sovereign Wealth Fund Institute by Carl Lena Bird and Michael Madwell. So, ito po, it will show transparency of the investments. Yan po. And ethical standards. Ayan, meron po yan. So, may grading system po. So, ito kasama din po ito sa pinag-aralan. There are principles of Lena Bird Madwell Transparency Index. I can also share this with you po para makita nyo po. There's an index. There are ratings also. So,
chat group ko.
Yeah, opo. I-send ko po sa inyo to. Maganda siya.
Po, ano?
So, there's, makikita po doon if there's lack of fiscal prudence, additionality, undermining mga independence and transparency, accountability, risk assessment, investment.
Why
yeah.
is it na it is getting a bad press, the Sovereign Wealth Fund?
Hindi ko po alam.
No,
maybe because it's something new,
di
ba? It's something new, so that's why at least po it's a legislation, so may time pa po yung public and yung public po to still provide their inputs. Sabi ko nga po, medyo mahaba pa po to. Let's respect the process of making a legislation.
So if the House succeeds to pass this on second and third reading, because they are expecting the President to certify this when it comes tomorrow night, pwede lang habulin. So the next, as a process, legislative process, will go to the Senate.
Yes po, aakit po to sa Senate. And then babasahin po ng Senate for first reading, and then they will I think baka Committee on Banks din siya, kasi Committee on Banks po siya primary committee sa House eh.
Tapos Vice and Minister, kasi may mga tax measures na, no? So that will gain support from the economic team.
Yes,
and I'm glad to have these conversations with you. I am more enlightened about the Maharlika Fund, and I'm giving the floor to give your closing remarks, ma'am.
Okay. Again, thank you very much for this lively chat with all of you. Thank you for your support sa DBM. I know that lagi niyo po kami sinusulat. Maraming salamat po. I think it is part of our advocacy also to really inform the people po kung saan po, kung paano po ginagawa ang budget, how we prepare it, and how we utilize it. And yun po, sana po we will continue to be working hand in hand po para for better Philippines and to attain our agenda for prosperity. Thank you
alam
po.
Alam mo ma'am, pardon me, pero meron ko nakalimutan i-take up sa iyo kasi you're supposed to be the brains of this prosperity. Prosperity program.
It's the theme po of our economic transformation and our 8-point socio-economic agenda.
Ano yung prosperity na yung prosperity program na yun?
Yung 8-point socio-economic agenda natin. So, sana po, ang gusto po natin talaga dyan is given our 8-point socio-economic, meron po tayong objectives, di po ba? Maging higher income class, yes. Bumaba yung single-digit poverty level, ganyan po, yan po. Para po ma-attain natin yan, meron tayong 8-point socio-economic agenda. From our end po, we will try to fund, i-align po natin ang budget natin doon sa 8-point socio-economic agenda to achieve yung goals po natin sa MTFF.
Maganda lang yung title, prosperity. Aspire for prosperity.
Hindi po. Pero it's part of our program po. We increased it sa NEP and I think it's the same. We increased it by 39% po. Opo. Sa NEP.
Best figures, ma'am. 39%.
Aha. Kasi more than... I'll check. Nagulo na. I'll check po kung ano siya sa GAB. Yes, 39.
Kasi
agriculture
secretary, presidente. Anyway.
Tamalin po.
Yung sa agriculture, kasi yung inflation and everything and importation, hindi man dumadaan sa importation eh, di ba?
Ay, hindi po.
Support the farmers. Magano siya?
Picture na natin.
against the light dyan.
Come against the light.
Five billion pala.
Oh. Tama ba? Yeah, 5 billion. Ang ganda ng model. Kaya tataka ko, but why is getting the bad press na ang ganda-ganda pala ng model. Anyways, I'd like to thank our next, ano, our, sabi ko, next finance secretary. Anyway, magandang-magandang mga grupo sa inyo lahat at pasasalamat namin kay Secretary Amena Pangandaman na ngayon ang namin nakilala at nakaulayaw. So, Merry Christmas again to you, ma'am. And good luck for the 2023 signing of the budget. Friday. Yeah. Oh, nga pala, kailangan mag-start ng 2024 budget.
Lalabas po siguro yung budget ko mga February. So, first quarter.
Ah, okay. Maaga. Talo ng maaga pa masipag. Okay. Okay, on that note, I would like to thank you. Thank you very much, ma'am, for giving us your busy time with us.
Nadidili yung sweldo ng national government agencies. Ano yun, PS yan? Release ka agad yan. Ako ang may hawak ng budget, nasa DOF ang pera.
Ay, sumama. Ay, sumama. Ah, dito. Pampulay.